Stanford University.
So I guess it's time to start. Today there will be a lecture about the, well, how we learn about the beginning of our universe and about its structure. The speaker is John Carlstrom. He is a professor from Chicago University. He is one of the leaders of modern observational cosmology, and the word modern appears because it's really extremely high tech. On the other hand, you cannot often easily find him on email, etc., and on phone as well, because he spends lots of time on near the South Pole. So you call him, oh, yeah, I am going to go to the South Pole. So cannot talk right now. Oh, I am at the South Pole. No, at that time he doesn't answer. Anyway, so it was pretty difficult to find him, to get him here, but I am sure that you will be duly entertained. So thank you, and
thank you, Andre. Am I in? Okay. You hear me? Okay, great. So yes, I do go to the South Pole, and in fact, that is the main reason I go down there. That's a telescope we built down there, and that'll come into the story as I'm giving it. And I want to tell you about, you know, what do we know about the Big Bang? How did we learn about it? And this telescope will come in, as will other things. But I have to start with some background first. So let's see if I can work this. There we go. So some background first. So before I talk about the Big Bang, I want to talk a little bit about the universe and what led up to even learning about the Big Bang. So what do we know about the universe and how do we know it? So here's a first fact. Someone said, I want to hear facts. Well, the universe is really big. So you should all know that. And the reason I bring this out is not because you didn't know that, but because every time we turn around and make more measurements, we realize maybe it's a lot bigger than we thought. And that story started a while ago. So this is a picture from the South Pole. This is one of the people. We have a few people who spend the winter down there. We set up a video camera. Unfortunately, it's getting faded out a little bit. But you could see that here, when you look at from the South Pole and you look up, you see the Milky Way. And it's not rising and setting. It's just spinning above you because we're at the South Pole, right? That light that's flashing, that's the aurora. This is just in 2 days. Aurora is always coming up and down. Some of the streaks you see going by are satellites. But what I want to draw your attention to, which it comes around a little better, is the Milky Way. In fact, why don't we just go on to the next slide. Down here. There we go. So that's the Milky Way. You know about the Milky Way. 100 or so years ago, this was thought to be, of course, they didn't have such beautiful images of it, but they could see the Milky Way with their eye, just like you could see it in that video. But that was the universe. The Milky Way was the universe. People were mapping out what it looked like. And now, of course, we know that's not really the whole universe, but that was the thought and belief. And there's these dark spots. They weren't really sure what that was. We now know that's dust. And dust will prominently come up in my story later. And so where you don't see stars is not because there aren't stars in these in down here anyway. It's because it's blocked by dust. And this is looking towards the center of the galaxy. And if you went to the center of the galaxy or sent light from the center of the galaxy, it would take about 25,000 years to reach us. So that's kind of what the universe is like, tens of thousands of light years across. That's pretty big. Made up of stars. So it's kind of fun to look around, zoom in. We can zoom in on another little, piece of the galaxy. And so there's all these beautiful stars, and stars come in different colors, different brightnesses. It's really beautiful. And I don't study any of this. Although now, when you look at that in light of the last several years, you could say, gosh, just think how many planets are around all those stars. But that's beautiful. But at this time in the early universe, there were these funny smudges, they look like, in photographic plates. These things which actually were cataloged by Messier, cataloged these things because they kind of diffuse smudges on the sky. And they wanted to catalog them so people wouldn't look at those pesky things when they were looking for comets as they got in the way. And there were debates about what they could be. But it was Edwin Hubble, and this is his image from 1923, you can see there, who was looking at one of these smudges, and you know, look, this is a, I should say it's a negative. So dark here is bright starlight, and where you see these kind of light streaks, that's actually dust lane, so it's a negative. But he saw that one of these, kind of a very faint star, was variable, and he could recognize that it was a very, very well-known star called the Cepheid, and they're enormously bright. He could recognize by its variability what it was, but it was so dim that it couldn't fit in the Milky Way. It couldn't fit in what he thought the universe was. And so he figured out that actually, no, it's a whole nother galaxy. It's a whole nother star system. And today, in fact, I took a long time doing it. Look at these three little stars up here. And then I'm going to bring on the next image. Right? I'm going to try. There it goes. You see those three little stars are there? This is an image now with a more modern, you know, optically sensitive telescope, and we can recognize that right away. Right? That's M33. That's the largest large, that's, sorry, it's the nearest large galaxy to the Milky Way. Light coming from the M33, or the Andromeda galaxy, takes about 2.5 million years to reach us. So it's 2.5 million light years away. So that's a huge increase in what we're thinking for the size of the universe, right? And that was, you know, roughly 100 years ago, a little less. Right, so that's Andromeda. We also know the universe is expanding. So it's made up of galaxies, and we'll talk more about galaxies in a second. We know it's expanding, and this was Hubble again. So he found out there's these other galaxies, and he started studying those. And so what any scientist tends to do when they are trying to study something, they're trying to get some information, they start cataloging. What it is that, you know, scientists love to plot things. So they're measuring a couple of things. So, you know, maybe here tonight you're saying, God, how many minutes has it been into this lecture? And I really am, I got to check my phone, right? And as the lecture goes on, you know, you might find out there's a correlation between these two. Right, and then you say, well, I'm going to fit that correlation, and I'm going to predict by the end of this lecture just how much, right? So they look for correlations, and then you try to use your correlations to make predictions, and then you go and test that. So what Hubble was doing is he was plotting the distance, and of course he didn't measure distance very well. It's very hard to measure distances, but he could kind of say how big these things were and correlate that with this, you know, how bright the stars were to get some idea of their distances. Versus how fast they seem to be moving. Positive being away from us, negative being towards us. And he did that by the Doppler shift. You know, if you look through a prism at sunlight, of course you don't do that, actually it's a bad idea to do that, but if you look at light, you see spectral lines, and those lines move around in wavelength with velocities. That's how a radar gun works. Or, you know, if a train is coming towards you and you hear a high pitch, you know, and then it shifts, that's when it goes the other way. That's the Doppler shift. So you can get velocities very accurately. And so sorry, I keep going ahead of myself here. You're right, it's tricky to get the thing right. So he could measure this accurately, this was not so rough. And he said, my gosh, look at that. There's some linear relation. The farther away galaxies are, each one of these things now is a galaxy discovered, the faster it appears to be moving away from us. Right, so this was interesting, and this is the telescope he used it to do this work up there, the 100-inch telescope outside of Pasadena. Here's this picture, which I know flashed up earlier, Einstein looking through a telescope. So this is a completely, you know, this is a completely framed stage figure because Einstein is a theoretician. They don't look through telescopes. Hubble was a master observer and you know, instrumentalist, experimentalist. And he would never smoke a pipe near all this equipment. Right? You wouldn't do that. So you know it's framed. But why is this such a meaningful picture? It's because Einstein, years before, had applied his famous theories of relativity, general relativity, to the universe as he knew it. And of course, the universe was static. The universe was stars in the Milky Way. They weren't all flying away from us. They weren't all flying towards us. And so he added this constant to his equations, like a constant of integration called the cosmological constant. We now call it lambda. The story goes, of course, you know, whoa, you know, his biggest blunder ever, is what some had said, that didn't need that, right? He could have predicted that the universe is unstable and should be expanding or that, but he missed that one. He got a lot, but he missed that one. So an amazing thing. So you could argue, though, boy, that's not that much data. Is that really holding up? And so here's a plot done. Actually, I found this by Bob Kirshner on looking at distant galaxies, looking how bright the supernova were. They're about the same. And this little red square, that's where Hubble's data is. So this trend just keeps continuing. And now we know it goes much, much farther. In fact, the big amazing thing is it goes much, much farther and then slightly starts to bend. And we'll talk about that later. It's rather bizarre. So the universe is expanding, right? The farther away a galaxy is, the faster it's moving away from us. And it's pretty tight. It's pretty amazing. So what does that mean? We say the universe is expanding. So you can do this exercise. So this is just playing around on PowerPoint, draw a little symbol, call it a galaxy, spread them around. And then with the instant push of a button, you can expand this little universe 10%. Maybe that's what would happen after a billion years or something. Actually, much less than a billion years, but 100 million years or something. So it expands. So here's my expanded universe. Expand again, right? All I'm doing is changing a scale. I'm not moving things away from each other, just changing the scale of the paper, if you will. And now you can say, well, what does it look like? Let's say you're on this galaxy, I think this one here. That's your home. And you want to know, what would you measure for the universe? Well, you could put these together. And what you would see on your special spot in the universe is that the galaxies near you are moving in that time, they moved a little bit, but the ones that are far away have moved a lot, right? Same over here, they've moved a lot, but your neighbors have barely moved. So if you plotted the speed versus distance, you would get a perfectly linear line, just like we see in the universe. But remember, we haven't moved the galaxies. We just essentially stretched the paper out. And you could say, well, that's the special spot. You know, what about over here? Well, of course, if you did that same exercise there, you see the same thing, right? Or you could pick any random spot here, anyone, and line them up. Everyone, wherever they are, sees the same thing. So when we talk about the universe is expanding, first off, it's not expanding from a spot. It's not that it's exploding out. It's that space is expanding. And one of the things I'll mention briefly later is that we have data that shows you these things are not moving through space. The space itself is expanding. It's kind of interesting. So there's no center, and there's expanding everywhere. Okay. So another fact. This is the deepest ever, by deepest I mean the most sensitive image taken of the universe in optical light, light that we see. This is from the Hubble Space Telescope. You can see Hubble had a lot of influence in the field. They're naming the space telescope after him. This is a small little part of the sky. It's smaller than the tip of your pinky held at arm's length. It's just this tiny little part of the sky that the Hubble telescope just zoomed in and integrated a long time to get an image. Everything you see in this image, every little blip of light, is a galaxy. Not a star, a galaxy, right? So this is picking apart where you can look through our galaxy without being contaminated by a lot of starlight. So I have an interesting number for you here, right? That number is 100 billion, okay? Why is that interesting number? Well, 100 billion is the number of stars in the Milky Way, roughly. And if you take this image, right, and say, okay, I know I can count how many galaxies are there, so how many galaxies are in the whole sky, and you get a number that is 100 billion. And so I use that as the number of galaxies in the observable universe. And I put observable in there for a while. We probably can't see the whole universe. That's the observable universe, right? It's also the age of the universe in dog years, right? The universe is about, our universe is about 14 billion years old, and we all know one human year is seven. How does it go? It's 7 to 1, dog years, right? And I used to say, I used to have another bullet that said it's also the cash reserves of Apple. But that's much larger now, so I had to drop that line. Yeah, right. But here's the most, for a cosmologist, someone studying the universe, the most interesting thing is it's mainly black. Right? So you have this very deep, you have this very deep image, and you look in one spot, and that ray that you're looking along never hits a galaxy. Right? You've seen, you're not seeing a galaxy. Most of this is black. Right? So we phrase that as we're seeing past the galaxies. We're seeing to a time. Now, what do I mean seeing to a time? Well, if you're looking farther away, it takes time for light to reach you. You're looking back in time. So you're seeing past the galaxies to a time before galaxies formed. Right? So we have this expanding universe, not expanding from any one spot. Space is expanding. And it's evolving, because we're able to see to a time when there were no galaxies. Right? So that's interesting. Okay. But it turns out that actually this guy is very bright in all directions and very uniformly bright. It's just not at wavelengths your eye can see. And this is a remarkable fact. This is what has given me a career to study this. And it came about from a remarkable event that is about 50 years ago. And that was these rock stars. Not these rock stars. I think I recognize those guys. But about that time, these rock stars, Arnold Penzias and Robert Wilson, discovered this cosmic microwave background. They discovered that at microwave wavelengths, peaking at about a millimeter wavelength, although they were looking at a couple centimeters, is glowing. In fact, they found this glow wherever they looked, and they didn't know what it was. And they thought, well, it must be they're seeing, you know, just the emission from the trees. At one point, you know, they thought, well, they found there was a bird nest in their funny-looking antenna here, and they cleaned that out. And after a couple of years of doing all these tests, and of course, this was all enabled by having a very sensitive receiver, they concluded it was astronomical from the sky. They called. They had heard that there was a group at Princeton that was looking into trying to make measurements, looking for some sort of background, and they called them up. And that's when the people at Princeton realized they'd been totally scooped. And they didn't need to build their instrument because it had already been detected. That was the cosmic microwave background. Remarkable event. It's a so-called the smoking gun, if you will, but the direct evidence of a hot Big Bang. Now, this was accepted right away as the explanation, and I'll say a little more. In fact, the article, the journal that came out, the very next article was the description of the hot Big Bang and how this was the remnant radiation from the very early universe. An interesting story is that, I gotta go back. By the end of the talk, I'll know how to use this thing. No, I forgot where I lost my train of thought. Bob Wilson. Bob Wilson once, he told me that the reason there's two articles is the Princeton group wanted to write one article, you know, all together. Here's the observation, here's the explanation. And he said, well, I know for sure the observations are right. I don't know about that theory. But anyway, they got the Nobel Prize. This is also staged, you can tell. Astronomers don't go out and work on this kind of equipment in coats and ties. They don't do that. But this is, I think, from when they did a little video for this and reenactment, kind of when they got the Nobel Prize for this work in 1978. Why this was so significant is that for decades before, people have been trying to work out, Ralph Alpher, Robert Herrmann were trying to work out where did the elements come from. And they'd worked out a theory that if the universe was much hotter earlier, that you could create the elements, you know, from a quark soup. It was in this hot Big Bang. And there was another theory, steady state theory, which might later sound familiar, where you just, the universe is somehow magically expanding and you're creating things, and they explained the redshift by some other mechanism. This was the deciding moment that we had a hot Big Bang. In fact, Big Bang term was made by Hoyle as a derogatory mark. You know, your theory is nothing but a Big Bang, that kind of remark. And it is a Big Bang. Let's go on here. Okay, so here's the idea, just kind of in summary. So there's time going on, today, past, future. And so today we have our galaxies, we have some sort of density, taking a cube out of the universe. In the future, right, it gets less dense, cooler, right? That's what's going to be happening. In the past, it was hotter and denser. And you can go back a little farther in the past to a point before the galaxies formed. In fact, you can go to a point before even hydrogen formed. So when hydrogen first formed, the universe was just a transparent gas. Just in some sense, it would be just hydrogen, but you can see through gas. You guys see me just fine. And thank God there's a whole lot of molecules that are here. We're not in a vacuum, and you can see right through it. But if you took and ionized the gas in this room, right, you wouldn't be able to see the tip of your nose, right? You just would scatter, your light would scatter off all the free electrons, and of course you would die very quickly because it would be no energy, you'd be in trouble. So even going back earlier, you have this universe being this opaque plasma. So you have this, we're getting towards the Big Bang, but you have the early universe, this is opaque plasma. Electrons are not tied up with the protons to make hydrogen yet. When they do that, the universe cools off enough to do that, then you can get this transparent gas, and then eventually you start forming structure. So this is how the universe evolves. Okay? So the lab wanted to make these fancy drawings for me. I think these are more instructive here. So you can picture the early universe. Just think of it as a simple gas. In fact, it's very simple. Not when you go real early, but when it was opaque. So you have, photons. Well, photons, are squiggly lines. You have protons. They're not moving around very much because they're heavy. And you have electrons, which are not tied to the protons. There's too much energy for them to form hydrogen. And they're whizzing around and interacting with the light. And so it's all plasma. The light's all scattering. And if you were to take this material and try to compress it a little bit, well, then it gets denser, and the photons scatter even more, and it'll want to bounce back because the photons are trying to push it out. So it supports that rarefaction, compaction, and rarefaction. It supports sound waves. So you have this plasma and sound waves in it, right? That's about it. Simple. If you take that now and go forward in time, where the universe is cooling off, it's expanding, it's cooling off, you get to a point. So here's time coming towards us. You get to a point where if you look back further, you're looking back to a time when it's ionized and it has just those sound waves. But if you look not quite so far back, it's formed atoms and you can see it. So if you think about it, think about the sun, right? We see the sun, right? We see right to it, but we don't see a surface. We see what looks like a surface of the sun, but it's a gas. What we're seeing is when the light last scattered, right? So a photon inside the sun might take a million years to bouncing around electrons before it gets to the surface, but then there's no more electrons to scatter, and 8 minutes later, that gets all the way to the Earth, traveling at the speed of light. So think of the universe, or our view of the universe, like an inside-out sun. We're sitting here. Of course, we always think we're here in the middle, and any direction you look out, you're looking back in time, and you look back to a time when the universe was ionized. And then you will see this surface. So you see this, what looks like a surface, a photosurface. That is like an inside-out sun. That is the cosmic microwave background. That's what Arnold Penzias and Bob Wilson had discovered, what they saw. That's what I've been studying for a long time. Okay. So let me, since you're all experts here, that's what it looks like from here. What does it look like if you were here? Same thing. Yeah, very good. There's no middle. It looks like we're in the middle, but that's just because everywhere we look back in time. It takes the same distance out to look back to that same part in time. Okay. So again, the lab, they'd like to do fancier things. So this is the same idea. Here we are. We're looking out. You see past where the galaxies are, you see where it's just this uniform gas, but it's not ionized. When it's ionized, it's opaque. And this picture is not showing you what goes beyond that. That picture will come up again later. right? Anyway, we could see this, right? We could see this cosmic microwave background. What an amazing gift. We could see it. We can develop, get more sensitive, you know, imaging, not just detect it, but to get imaging, and we could develop baby pictures of our universe, right? Because we're using the fact that light takes time to travel to do that. So that's the next thing. Let's look for structure. What did the universe look like? And what we should see eventually is all the structure that through 14 billion years in time led to the stuff we see around us today, right? So that was, made sense. Theorists were saying, you know, we should do it, should be out there. Maybe it's fluctuating at 10% level, 1%. Well, it turned out that it wasn't so easy. It took 30 years of various experiments and people looking with ever more sensitive, you know, instrumentation and imaging before they saw any structure. It was the same. Every direction you look, it had the same intensity, same spectrum. They couldn't find any variation. It was just very, very smooth, right? In fact, it's smooth to a part. I'll show you the COBE satellite actually detected it. Let me show you what it looked like. Looks like noise, beautiful noise though. It's smooth to a part in 100,000. Now, how smooth is that? Well, let's say you're walking around and you find a stone and you pick it up and it's as perfect sphere and as polished as a well-polished ball bearing. That's how smooth this surface is. So when I show this image here, this is meant to be the whole sphere surrounding us, I'm just highlighting the fluctuations. But they're small. The brightest to the dimmest spot, and we like to say hottest to coolest, we use those in one for the other, is smooth to a part in 100,000, right? So this is the what's called the smoothness problem. Some people call it a horizon problem. And the reason it's a problem for physicists or something to work on, is here we are, we're sitting here looking out at the sky, and we look, let's say, that direction. And we measure how intense it is, we measure its spectrum, and we get an answer. And we look this opposite direction, and we measure its intensity and spectrum, and you compare the two, and they're almost precisely, in fact, for 30 years, we couldn't tell the difference. They're that accurate. So how did that happen? What synchronized them? Because here we are in the middle, in that spot that we're looking at, that light is traveling to us at the speed of light for almost the age of the universe, and the same here, and they've only gotten halfway to each other. They haven't yet communicated with each other. So how are they synchronized? Right? What led to them being synchronized? Right? Or another way of saying it is if you're on that side, this part of the universe is outside of your horizon. You can't talk to it yet. In fact, you have to wait another 14 billion years before you get your signal sent over there. So that's the smoothness problem, or one way to phrase it. Okay. So these guys also got the Nobel Prize in 2006 for discovering the anisotropy and also measuring the spectrum very precisely. So here's how you solve this smoothness problem. It's actually easy to say. And then I'm a little worried with Andre here behind me. He's not looking too happy with my explanations. It's easy. You go in the first, let's say, 10 to the minus 35 seconds of the universe. That's pretty fast, pretty early. And you expand the universe. You stretch the space by something like 10 to the 30 times. And you do this in this era, this early. Oops. Anyway, that's inflation. You do this in this expanding the space and accelerating faster than the speed of light expansion. Now you might say, well, you can't do that. Einstein said nothing travels faster than the speed of light. And the real phrase of that is nothing can communicate or can be transmitted faster than the speed of light. There's no speed limit to how fast space itself can expand. And there are solutions to Einstein's equations, which, if you have things, and it's called a false vacuum, but you will then drive this expansion. And if you can maintain that state, you will drive this faster than the speed of light expansion. So basically, these parts of the universe were, they were in contact with each other. They thermalized, they were all together. And then this expansion started, and then they were pushed out of the horizon. They were pushed out so far away from each other that even today, signals from one part to the other are not able to reach each other. Right? Crazy theory? Yeah, okay. That's inflation. That's a lot of inflation, right? I mean, a little inflation is supposed to be good for the economy. This would be devastating for the economy, right? This is a big deal, right? It's cool in many ways. And I should say the scale of this is that for this model of the universe, this inflationary model for the origin of our universe, the initial space, you know, is something like 10 to the 14th, 10 to the, you know, 0.00140 times the diameter of a proton, one proton, right? And that led, that volume, that little volume led to our entire observable universe, right? Pretty amazing. So in that model, what we're seeing when we make these maps, why I said this is really a beautiful map, is that these fluctuations, these slightly hotter, slightly cooler spots, you know, is quantum fluctuations, quantum fuzz that's been stretched out effectively to our observable universe, right? And leading to all the seeds of structure of everything that formed in our universe. So the largest things in our universe in this model for the start, for the Big Bang, began as minuscule quantum fluctuations. In fact, the whole universe started as what today we would say is, you know, undetectably small fluctuation. So pretty amazing. In fact, what we should say is everything began as these minimum quantum fluctuations. You know, Carl Sagan has said we're star stuff because the heavier elements were made in the stars. We're made out of star stuff. He could have said we are amplified quantum fluctuations. Right? It might not have sold as well. It doesn't quite have the jingle, but it's an amazing thing. Okay. So when we look at these maps, I wanted to kind of go back to this idea of sound waves. So let's say you had a, you know, tone in a room, you know, like a tuba making a tone, and give it a real pure tone, and it would make sound waves. And let's say you took a snapshot, or you took a real fast camera, something that could detect heat, an infrared camera, could detect radiation. You could see this pattern, right? You'd see the white slightly hotter, and you'd see the rarefaction, where it gets denser, a little hotter. You could see that pattern. You'd see it in the sound waves. And if you had a flute playing a higher pitch note, you'd see the same type of thing if you had a sense enough camera. That's really what's going on. And let's say you had 1,000 of these instruments all playing around. Then you might see something like that, right? Looks like noise, right? And you say, well, you know, I want to see really what's making that. So you could do this technique that's used all the time in experimental physics and mathematics, and make a spectrum of that. In fact, you guys are used to thinking of spectra if you think of a graphic equalizer. So basically, you know, what is the signal amplitude of the bass, and you know, you have all these components, and you could say, well, that's the spectrum of that sound, right? But you could, it'd be kind of slow, but you could get your fancy camera and take this picture and then analyze that picture and come up with the same thing. You wouldn't have to do it with a microphone. You could do it with a picture. And that's what we do basically when we look at the cosmic microwave background, right? Let me just go to that. So this is not the COBE satellite. This is a more recent satellite image of our universe, cosmic microwave background. It has many frequencies, so they're able to, you know, figure out, separate the emission from the galaxy and stuff. But that's what it looks like. This is really a spectacular image. It's an image of our early universe, 14 billion years old. That's what it looked like. It's all the seeds, and you can see there's some large patches that are a little cooler, some that are hotter, and a structure all over. It's really quite amazing. And you could say, all right, I'm going to do that analysis and look at this and see what is the spectrum of our universe. And it really is these like sound waves, very, very, very long wavelengths, or low frequency, if you will. In fact, they're so low frequency that if you waited 10 years and took the image again, you would not be able to detect any difference, right? So not like sound in a room. These are very low frequency or very long wavelengths. But if you took the spectrum, this is what you get, right? And this is a remarkable thing. Almost every physics process in nature, if you look at the spectrum, what you'll see is there's lots of power at base, and then it just falls off, and you go to higher. It's like if you take a soda, right, and you mix it up a little bit, pretty soon it all goes, and it all gets bubbly in real small scales. So there's a lot of power at large scales, and it cascades down to small scales. It's kind of natural. It's called 1 over F noise. Our universe isn't doing anything like that. Instead, it looks like an instrument, actually. You know, an instrument, you have a fundamental tone, and then you see overtones. That's what these are, overtones, right? And there's this, it's just strange. So it turns out this theory, which if Andre blocks his ears, we can all say this crazy theory of inflation, predicts exactly this. The line that goes through here, this red line, is a fit to an inflationary model, right? So that's pretty convincing. And in fact, there's another thing. If you remember, you were expanding this universe so much. Imagine you took a crumpled up piece of paper, right? And then you expanded it, just expanded a little bit, but not a little bit, 10 to 30 times. Then when you looked at that paper on any scale, in any spot, in fact, any spot, even size of the Earth, you would not be able to see a wrinkle in it. It would look perfectly flat because you stretched all that out. That's what inflation kind of did for our universe. So if inflation is right, we should see that the space, the geometry of space-time is flat. And what that means, a better way of saying that is uncurved. It means that light rays, if they're parallel, they will always stay parallel. They won't bend into each other. It's not like the surface of the Earth where you could take walk away from the South Pole and keep walking and then meet again at the North Pole. That's a curved surface, right? This is flat, right? In three dimensions, a little harder to think of, but that's what the universe should be. And this peak is very important for that. So here is from a textbook now, after some of this data has come out, saying that you can measure the curvature of the universe, see if it's what its geometry is, by saying, what does these maps look like? Right? And if the rays are such that they start curving in, like we would on the surface of an Earth, that's called a closed universe, then these things will look larger than they are. Right? You will think it's something is this big when it's that big. So this whole structure looks bigger. Here, if it's flat, they look as they are. And if it's closed, if it's going the other way, they'll look smaller. So that spectrum, if you had the universe be closed, then these things, this little thing would start to move, it would move this way. And if it was the other way, it would move this way. So inflation predicts it's got to be right there. And there it is. Right? This happened initially. These measurements were done not by the satellite, but they were done a little cruder only about 15 years ago. And that's where another big hit for inflation. And as I said already, inflation says you should have these harmonic peaks. I don't know of any other theory that tells you that. So let's go on. If you then know the curvature of the universe, in this case being uncurved, Einstein's theory tells you know actually the density of the universe, right? Remember the matter curves space. So if you know the curvature of space, you can solve for the density of space. How much stuff is out there? And so we can do that. And when you do that, this is what you get. You get that in the universe, the equivalent density, we're measuring very large scale, is about 3 atoms per cubic meter, right? The equivalent. It doesn't mean it's atoms, but that's the equivalent. Whereas in this room, the density of air in this room is roughly about 10 to the 27 atoms per cubic meter. So we live in a very special place. And we, of course, wouldn't be living if we lived in anything that had 3 atoms per cubic meter, at least not as we know it. So that's interesting. The other thing is that we can go and look, right? We know we're looking at these sound waves. We see how big the harmonics are. We know from the photons, remember, look at the early universe, the photons are what are pushing all those electrons out. right? I'm trying to bounce about around them. But there's dark matter, right? And the dark matter is trying to pull everything in through gravity. And so we can solve for those dynamics. We can solve for those constituents in the early universe. And when we do that, this is what we get. We find out that all the stuff that we know about, the stuff you can read about in your textbooks, the stuff that's led to the whole electrons and all the industry and every revolution we've ever had in technology, everything we know about is a little less than 5% of the average stuff in the universe. Now, astronomers have known for almost 80 years now that there's some other matter that doesn't light up. They call it dark matter. Astronomers are very creative with names. Dark matter, all right? And that makes up 25%, right? But we know, because of the curvature, we know what the total amount is. And even though prior to these measurements, we used to think that was all there was, dark matter and normal matter, ordinary matter and dark matter. But no, in the last 20 years now, a little less than 20 years, we realized there is, most of the universe is in some other form, right? And we call it some other form of matter or energy density, so it's called dark energy, right? That's the name for it. So rather amazing, we have this dark energy, right? Now the amazing thing about this, going all the way back to Einstein, is the simplest explanation, or ready-made explanation, is that dark energy is what you get if you just interpret Einstein's cosmological constant. It tells you how it will behave. It tells you the magnitude that you know, what you put in front of this, what the value of this is. But it acts just like Einstein's cosmological constant. So his cosmological constant was this term he added to make the universe stable, right, and make it static. Actually, it would make the universe static, but it wouldn't be stable. It would then take off and start to expand, fits this data, right? And we get at this from CMB. We get at it, as I said, we measure the whole. We know these components. We get at this using a very high-level mathematical technique called subtraction. This is what's left over, right? But if it's a cosmological constant, it should be causing the universe, expansion of the universe, to accelerate. That's pretty weird. So the universe, you know, we had this inflation, this hyper-expansion, and then it starts to slow down. As it's slowing down and cooling off, structures start to form. You get atoms get together. You finally form stars and galaxies, and somehow, amazingly enough, us. But this is saying the expansion should be accelerating. So that's kind of a little crazy. But around this same time, in fact, a little bit before, like a year before, astronomers, they were going out measuring. They figured out how to standardize, how to realize how bright supernovae were, which are extremely bright. A single supernova can outshine an entire galaxy. In fact, this is a real image. It's not an artist's rendition. This is from the space telescope. And they were mapping these supernova at higher and higher redshift, and they found that what they expected to find was the so-called deceleration parameter. How fast is the universe slowing down? Because that'll tell you how much matter is in it, right? Because matter through gravity pulls things together. It slows down the expansion. Instead, they found out the universe was accelerating, right? So at the same, within a couple of years, both of these, this our work, cosmic microwave background, the supernova people discovered the universe is accelerating, and there's this thing called dark energy, right? So this is Einstein on the cover of Science, basically his biggest blunder, as it's been said, turns out to be perhaps the explanation for this newly discovered phenomenon. Right? And these guys, Saul Perlman, Brian Schmidt, I hate it when I skip out on names. I'm getting older. No, he's like John Hopkins. Adam Rees, thank you so much. I know Adam very well. I'm just having one of those moments. Got the Nobel Prize for this in 2011. Adam Riess. Yes. So we have this model, right? You know, this model, the Big Bang with inflation and dark matter. You know, that dark matter is flowing through us right now. We're trying to look for it in the universe. And what I actually didn't say, but should have, is what we learn by looking at the cosmic microwave background, we learn that the dark matter is not just coal or failed ordinary matter. It's not glowing. We actually learned that it's some new form of matter, some yet unknown form of matter. Right? That's something that's come from our observations. So it has these three. We have this model. It seems to fit all the data. The amazing thing about all the observations, but it has dark matter, which we don't know what it is, have never detected it directly. It has dark energy, which is even weirder, and I'll tell you why. And it starts with inflation, which, block your ears again, which you all agreed was crazy, right? So that's our model of the universe. That's the Big Bang. So that's, you know, we've got to do a little more than that. So what the heck is dark energy, and did inflation really happen, right? That's what we want to go after now. That's driving the field. Or are there more discoveries to be made, right? So here's a little cartoon just to give you a sense of this dark energy. So in the early universe, you know, dark matter is king, right? It's controlling everything. This constituent of the universe is going to shift with time. And the reason for that is dark energy is just I'm never going to get this right. Here we go. Dark energy is just a property of space. You have more space, it's the same density all the time. At least that's this cosmological constant model. It's just the vacuum energy. So as the space expands, what's happening is you dilute the dark matter. It's kind of pulling things together. Its ability to pull things together is weakened because the space is expanding. Meanwhile, that means dark energy has a bigger role to play in the dynamics. And so the acceleration goes even more. So today, you know, and that, you know, that pie chart I showed you, you know, dark matter is about only, you know, about half, a little less, maybe a third as important as dark energy, right? The universe, as a consequence, is accelerating. The expansion is accelerating. And so it doesn't take much to predict what's going to happen in the future unless we discover something is wrong. And that is, it's just going to be Mr. Dark Energy's universe, right? It's going to take over. And in fact, if this model is right, in a billion or 2 years, cosmology would be very easy because we'd look out and there wouldn't be any other galaxies to see, right? They'd all be pushed out beyond the horizon, right? So another crazy, right? We have to test this, and we want to test inflation. And to do that, we need more measurements. So I'm going to concentrate on the cosmic microwave background measurements, but there are other measurements that are also important. Okay. So for more data, there are two sites in the world which we're put these kind of weird telescopes. In fact, the thing I forgot to point out, but when I showed that early picture of Arnold Penzias and Bob Wilson standing in front of their telescope, kind of summing up the statistics and the precision of cosmology at that time, you could say that showed you that all cosmic microwave background telescopes look weird and that half of the cosmologists are bald. So this is proving the point. I think these telescopes are beautiful, but they're odd looking. I agree. This is in Atacama, Chile. This is a site almost 6,000 meters high and dry in the desert. That's why it's there. And here's the South Pole, where we have the South Pole Telescope and actually the Keck and Bicep Array telescopes. These are exceptionally good sites. And the reason we want to be dry is, think about it, we're looking at microwaves. And if you know in the morning your coffee gets a little cold, you stick it in a microwave oven. Microwaves get absorbed and emitted by water. So if there's any water in the atmosphere, it really messes up your observations. So these are sites are above a lot of the water vapor because they're high, and then they're super dry deserts. In fact, the South Pole, I think, is the driest spot on Earth. All right. So these are just those sites again, showing the telescopes that are on them. This one, you know, kind of looks like you're out, and it, very much it's kind of primitive. And here's the South Pole with those telescopes. So I want to give you a break from thinking too hard and just give you a little intermission now, a little travelogue, if you will, about what it's like. Everyone wants to know, how do you get to the South Pole? Well, you fly commercial airlines to the United States Antarctic Program's base, which is in Christchurch, New Zealand, and from then on, you're cargo. If you're really lucky, you get in one of these, the Globemaster, which is a big jet, so you can get down to the coast of Antarctica in only 4 or 5 hours. If you're not so lucky, you get in a prop plane. From there, you land on this is landing on the sea ice outside McMurdo, and usually by January, you can only go down between November and early February. By January or so, then they have to move you up to the ice shelf, because it starts to break up. And then you arrive at this place called McMurdo, which is, well, it looks like a mining town. It feels a lot like it looks when you're there. I'll be polite. This picture I show, this is Scott's cabin. Scott and Amundsen, this is when Scott went to the pole in 1911. It's still there. It looks like a Polynesian hut, because it's a Polynesian hut. He bought it on his way down there, and his men stayed there for a couple of years while he had his ill-fated hike to the South Pole. And you can go in and look, and there's still penguins that they slaughtered over 100 years ago. They're still there. It's really remarkable. The other thing that you can see when you're down there, if you're lucky, is all the penguins, of course. So this is on the coast. The coast is interesting. The penguins were all coming in. You're not allowed, there's the Antarctic Treaty, you're not allowed to approach them. You can't touch them. If they notice your presence, you could be arrested. But they don't care. They walk right up and around you, and they have no treaties. Anyway. Then you fly on one of these. This is these planes have great names. This is called the Hercules, and you can see it's ski equipped. So here we're still on the sea ice. You fly on that to the pole, to about 3 or 4 hours. You go up over the Transantarctic Mountains, and the glaciers are just incredible. And then you get to the high plateau, and that's the base. There's nothing for 100 miles. There's just this flat plateau. This is not, you know, just groomed snow for the runway. And if you look, actually, I can't even see it from here, but our telescope this is the year they're building it. Our telescope is there. There's the station. And this is all there. It looks like a junkyard. It's a lot like a junkyard where stuff is up. It's cold. It never gets above freezing. Nothing lives there. There's no life. There's no mice. There's no, I don't even think there's bacteria. It's very cold. And it's sunny like that when I'm down there. Remember I showed you earlier how the galaxy was just going overhead? When you're there in the summer, the sun just goes overhead. But it doesn't get very high. It's 23 degrees. And then, of course, it sets, and then you have 6 months of darkness where you can do these observations. This is arriving then, and on the plane, that's the station. Everything is in those black buildings, absolutely everything. Some people never go outside again. And everything that's down there that's built, including our telescope, comes out of the payload of these planes. Right? And it looks sunny in all these pictures, but I just thought a close-up and you'd see that it's about 40 below. In summer, if you're lucky, it gets up to, you know, 10 below or something. The average temperature in the night, that is the winter, is minus 80 degrees Fahrenheit. It's cold. And that's why we're there. There's our telescope, just showing it there. It is 10 meters, but the wavelengths we're looking at are about, they're millimeter, where your eye sees microns, or sees, you know, a tenth of a micron, I mean a half a micron or so. So the resolution of this telescope being 10 meters is about the same as what your eye sees in optical, right, the visual, so the detail that we can make out, right? And the telescope itself, of course, it's cold being down there, but our detectors, to get them to work and not add so much noise that we can't see these weak signals we're looking for, are cooled themselves to minus just a quarter of a degree above absolute zero, or minus 459 Fahrenheit. Okay. And this, I always like to show this because you never know. Every year I have to hire two people to go down there. And when we all get the last flight out in February, they stay and get the next flight in November. All right, so they're closed off. These are what we call our winter overs, and they're really our heroes. So you can see some are more hero-y than others. Dana in 2008, Dana in 2010, and in 2011. I thought he had another one. Dana here in 2013. He's been great. But every year we have two people go down, and they're our only eyes and ears and hands to work on things during the winter. So we have to treat it like almost like a satellite, make sure everything works remotely. This is the Chile Insight. And I said, send me some pictures and send me a video. This is the 6-meter telescope. Now here it's surrounded what they call a guard screen. So basically this is in microwaves reflective, so they can't have scattered light from the mountains and stuff coming in and contaminating their experiments. And you can see it's very barren, very much a desert. Over in the background there are these other smaller telescopes. There's polar bear telescopes. That's the name. They're about 2 meters in diameter. And these are the two sites. This is where all the ground-based work in this field comes from these days, these two sites. And I think I just have one of these pictures of the receiver. So this is our camera. Now, you're not going to be impressed because you have a cell phone that has I don't know how many megabytes of pixels. We are really proud because when I started doing this work, we would build cameras with 10 pixels. When we first put this telescope down, it had 1,000 pixels. And we just finished, I just came back from the pole last month, and we just finished putting this camera in, which has 16,000 detectors. So we're really speeding things up a great deal. And this whole thing, which is about 100 pounds, is cooled then to just a fraction above absolute zero. And that's the very happy team down there. Okay, back, intermission's over. So you have to think again. This is now, I showed you that map of the whole sky. It was done with the Planck satellite. This is a little piece of that sky. It's a little piece, 50 square degrees. It's about the size of your hand laid out, so small fraction of the whole sky. And you can see the detail. When we look at this now with the South Pole telescopes, much higher resolution, and actually with all these detectors and that, we're able to do much deeper, much lower noise as well. And so look at the same sky, and then it looks like that. So you can see there's a difference. So here's Planck. Oops. This is Planck, and then go to higher resolution, lower noise, and you can see that. So the first order, you know, the first thing you should see is looks the same. And that's because you saw that spectrum of what the sky is. And if you see on those scales where those big peaks are, you've got almost all the information. And another way of saying that is this frothy, cloud-like structure, that's what it really looks like. But you can see our resolution is much higher. We can see these bright sources, those are the center of galaxies which have black holes emitting really strong radiation. And in our really small beam, we can pick that out. That's kind of interesting. That's another talk. Those were known about. In fact, what we do is we rub them out of our data, essentially. We're not using those. What we are really excited about when we first saw this are these things, these little black spots. The screen doesn't show them up real well, but there's a few of them here. Here you go. And so these are shadows. They're actually shadows. We're looking and seeing a shadow in the cosmic microwave background. We're seeing, using this light, really as a backlight now, and looking for shadows. They're shadows of amazing things. They're shadows of these things called galaxy clusters. And here is a blow-up of one. I'm going to show you a picture of that. This is of order 1,000, 10,000 galaxies that, like our stars are in the Milky Way, these are galaxies that are all forming one much larger object. They're all bound to each other. So it's like a galaxy of galaxies, if you will. They are the largest things ever produced in our universe, right? So in this dark energy, dark matter tug of war, it's very sensitive to when these things got made. If they're still being made, then our theory of dark energy, you know, if we're still making, universe is still able to produce and make more of these galaxy clusters around us today, then this model of dark energy is wrong, right? Because it shouldn't be able to. That should be shut down, right? Dark energy would have wiped that out. So we have a way, by looking at these shadows, we have a way of mapping this out. So let me just tell you a little bit more about this. So this is, as I said, galaxy clusters, and their formation can allow us to trace this out. We can look for their cosmic history. This image that we're looking at is actually Hubble Space Telescope in the galaxies, but the purple is X-ray emission, right? We could turn off the optical, and this is X-ray color-coded to look purple, but it's X-ray emission. And the reason why is that most of the ordinary matter in these galaxy clusters is not in the galaxies. Kind of a misname, is actually in this very hot primordial gas that has been heated up because it's gotten so dense in these huge, massive galaxy clusters. A galaxy cluster is something like 10 to the 15 times the mass of our sun, or 10 to the 5, 100,000 times the mass of our galaxy. They're huge, right? And so that's X-ray emission. So now if you think about it, that's ionized gas. So these ionized gas should interact with light. And here it is emitting X-rays. But if we look at, shrink that down, take a microwave photon in our telescope and say, what happens if that comes towards us? Well, nothing much. Comes right to us. Because even with this huge galaxy, there's not a lot of scattering. Most of the photons get through. So we could try that again. Still happens. We could be here all night. Try it again. But it'll scatter. So sometimes it will scatter, and so some of the light that we would have seen from the background gets scattered. How much? Well, it depends how massive it is. But it doesn't depend on where it is. We're in its shadow. So this technique, looking for these things, and here's a real image, actually, from the other map, just blowing it up, allows us to find all of the galaxy clusters in the universe. All of them, no matter where they are. Because we see them in backlight, we see them as shadows. So we've done that. In fact, the telescope was the first to ever be able to discover galaxies with this technique. And when we do that, we can then test, well, does this dark energy model make sense? Do we see that they formed early and have stopped forming? And the bottom line is, once again, in this test, it completely fits the prediction of Einstein's cosmological constant. So we see the universe is not just expanding, but accelerating. We see that the structure in the universe seems to be consistent with this tug of war between dark energy pushing things out and dark matter trying to pull things together. It's weird. We're stuck with it. We still don't know what it is, but we'd like to learn. So there's dark matter. Dark matter we're looking for in labs right now. No one's found it yet. There's underground mines trying to look for these very chance things with dark matter. Hopefully sometime soon they'll detect it, but who knows? Dark energy, we know it's there, but we don't really know what it is. What about inflation? Well, first I want to point out, inflation is this incredibly rich theory. It's very, very fertile. It's led to this model for the universe. It's led to all sorts of investigations. It explains phenomena we haven't seen. It explains why the universe is so flat. It explains why that spectrum looks the way it does. It looks great. And in fact, there is Andre Linde here with Alan Guth and Alexei Starobinsky receiving the Kavli Prize for the development of cosmic inflation for that theory. It's fantastic. But you all agreed. It's crazy, right? So you know, it has energy scales. We talk about applying to the universe. It has energy scales almost a trillion times higher. I mean, crazy in the sense that it's out of the box, right? Not crazy in a bad idea. It's a wonderful idea. It's incredibly fertile. But as energy scales a trillion times our experience, what we're doing at the Large Hadron Collider, it requires new physics, just like dark matter and dark energy do, in this case, the inflaton. Basically, it is connects to quantum gravity, which we don't have a theory of, really. It predicts that it could produce more than our universe. In fact, there should be the multiverse. There should be many, many universes. So you might think that's all crazy, and yet it beautifully fits and has predicted and has passed every test thrown at it so far for the universe we observe in. So how can we test it even further? Or another way of saying is, could we see to inflation, right? So, you know, so this is, here's what we're, oh boy, I'll never get used to this. I'm sorry. Here is the cosmic microwave background. Here we are today. We see that, and we're inferring stuff here. But can we learn a little more? So there is a way. So this is, I stole this from the World Science Festival graphic. But, you know, we have gravitational waves. We've known they've been there for a long time. We actually detected one shaking the Earth by LIGO. That was just amazing. Well, it turns out that in inflation in the early universe, there should be gravitational waves created. Much, much larger wavelength, much more powerful than even the ones LIGO is detecting. Much, much longer, lower frequencies. And they are generic prediction of inflationary models. So, and not only that, if we can detect them, you know, so that in some sense it'd be like a smoking gun, just like the Big Bang was, but it allows us to learn a lot more about inflation. So that's the kind of holy grail of astronomy, is to try to detect these. So here is this timeline of the universe. We have you know, the Big Bang going to inflation, you know, then we have this very hot universe quark soup, leading to, you know, making hadrons or protons, nuclear fusion and the light elements. Eventually, the cosmic microwave background departs and the universe evolves, right? And we already talked about how there are sound waves in the early universe. And that's what we've been seeing. Those maps we see are sound waves. If there are inflationary gravitational waves, then the graphic's a little messy, but here are the density waves or sound waves. If there's gravitational waves, we'll also see those leave an imprint on the cosmic microwave background. In a sense, we're using the entire universe at that time as a gravity wave detector. That's the experiment we want to do. Right? And so in this picture I showed you before, we're not just looking for, you know, sound waves here, we're looking for gravitational waves. What will they do? And what they do is they impart this very low level, but very clean signature on the polarization of the cosmic microwave background. Right? And it looks like these swirls on the sky. What it will look like kind of in a cartoony form are these swirls on the sky is like this, right? If you plot how the polarization of the light is, it would look like that. In fact, this is not bad at all. The scale they should show up on is about a degree. The moon is half a degree. So Van Gogh is onto something. And it'll have this spiral-like pattern. That would be a telltale signature of inflation. That would be great. We'd set the energy scale of inflation. We'd be saying we're detecting quantum gravity. It'd be wonderful. That's what we're looking for. Polarization is really hard to measure, right? But we know when any time you have scattered light, it's polarized, right? That's why you wear polarized sunglasses to take the glare off the front of your car and the dashboard and water. Scattered light is polarized. So the cosmic microwave background, which is that, you know, we're seeing it scattered off the last surface, it's polarized. So a little over, almost 15 years ago now, we measured the polarization for the first time. Remember, this is now 10 years after we measured the fluctuations. It took that much longer to measure the polarization because it's that much weaker. So we measured the polarization, but there's no swirls. There was no swirls in this polarization, right? But it's a benchmark. About 5 years after that, No, 10 years after that, we measured the South Pole Telescope. We measured the swirls, but not at the right scale, not on these degree scales. We measured on much smaller scales. But still, it's another 10 years. And this is almost 50 years since the cosmic microwave background was measured. We're measuring that. That was a big result. And then about only a year after that, only a couple of years ago now, probably all of you heard this, the BICEPT experiment measured swirls on the right angular scale, right? Big news. The only problem was we didn't really know a whole lot about the dust in our galaxy. And even though it looked very convincing, it turned out, now that we have more data from the Planck satellite and more data from the team, it turned out that it wasn't, or at least most of it was not due to gravity waves in the universe, but to polarized emission from dust in our galaxy. Wonderful measurements, actually exquisite measurements, but not quite what we're looking for. So the hunt continues. All right. So what's next? Well, the next project, to get these sensitivities we need, as you've already told, it took 10 years to measure polarization, took another 10 years to measure those swirls, and they're still not deep enough. We need to do a much more ambitious project, and that's what we're doing now. And so I was here actually this week meeting with a big group of people, I'll show you a picture in a second, where we're going to meet this challenge by putting 10 or more telescopes, not 10,000 detectors, but 500,000 detectors on these sites, and we're going after nano-Kelvin sensitivity. We've been at micro-Kelvin sensitivity. Think about it, we're measuring the 3-degree background with sensitivity of micro-Kelvins. We're gonna go all the way to tens of nano-Kelvin or even nano-Kelvins. That's the big project. And so, you know, it took 30 years to measure the anisotropy, maybe this next 30, well, 30 cents then would be the next few years. We hope to measure this. And we have the whole community coming together to do that. So this is just a picture from the workshop, the fifth in a series of workshops for designing this instrument. And we hope to do this and measure this soon. So that's the end of my story here. Sorry it took a little long. But the bottom line is, you know, the cosmic microwave background measurements have revealed really a surprising in the underlying workings of our universe. Dark energy is weird. It's real, and it's really weird. And we're certainly closing in on the first instance or the dawn of time with these measurements and exploring our quantum mechanical origins. And I'll just say the background here is another one of these shots from the winter at the South Pole. Anyway, thank you very much for listening. So that's if dark energy is a real tough physics problem to crack. So when we solve, you know, go to this and say, what do we get for the cosmological constant? What do we get for the value of that constant? We can measure that, and we have a number, right? And it's not zero, but it's very tiny. If you ask theorists to use their tools they have at their disposal to predict what it should be, that calculation is the 120 orders of magnitude off. So that's not saying that they're getting wrong. Their tools are not up to the task at hand. They don't understand it.
That's from quantum physics, that prediction is
yeah, the yeah. But I don't see any of them saying, oh, you know, yeah. It's just a big mystery.
Right.
Right.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh.
Well, you could think, how do you know inflation has actually stopped? Inflation, as in this early epoch, certainly stopped, and because there's all the structure around, right? We're here. Structure form, stars form. So that had to stop. Your question might be, how do we know that this cosmological constant isn't it reoccurring, right? And it's at a very different energy scale, so it's a similar mechanism. It's the same mathematical expressions doing it, but presumably it's a different field that's causing it because the energy scales are so different. But as a mechanism, it really is the same type of mechanism.
So there's a debate going on about the Hubble constant. There's the data from
the
Commission that says that it's 66 or something like that. And then there's the data from the standard channeled approach, the division of the constant, which is about 70.
Yeah. There's a way. Yeah.
And I got a second question.
Okay.
Sorry. The second question might be really stupid, so pre-apologize. But you described how they were using that standard candle of the supernova to work out that the universe was expanding at an increasing rate.
Increasing now, yes.
But since the universe is expanding at an increasing rate all over, and we're not making time-delayed measurements, how does one measurement of a standard candle tell you that the universe is expanding at an increasing rate?
Let me remind me if I forget that question, but I want to go back to the first one before I forget it. So the question was, is that if you take our standard model, which I sort of explained to you, and you measure, as we did the cosmic microwave background, flat universe, you get lambda, so it all fits, just as I explained to you, it makes a prediction of how fast the universe should be expanding today. And it actually is 68 kilometers per second per megaparsec. So, you know, there's an actual number. It also tells you the age of the universe. When we go and then today measure the how fast things seem to be moving away from us, and those actually measure the expansion rate today, we get a number that's remarkably close. The one is 68, I think the other one is 72, 73. And that precision is pretty amazing because one is coming from making measurements of the universe 14 billion years ago and extrapolating to today. And then you measure today, and that's how close they are. But the precision is so tight now that they are the chance of them being as off as much as they are is like it's about 3 sigma, it's about a part in 1,000. So it's significant, there's tension. And that we love it. We love it. We've been trying to break this model for 15 years. We love it when there's tension. It says there's something exciting. So not only is it, you know, have dark energy and these weird things, but it doesn't quite fit all the measurements. That's a clue for a hint at a crack in the egg that maybe we can get somewhere. One thing you can do is add another very light particle that changes the prediction from the Big Bang, and you can bring everything into alignment again. And there's a few other tricks you can do, but all those require new physics, right? You know, adding physics we don't know about. So you're a little reluctant to do that until you really have proof. So the debate, when this debate first started, the evidence wasn't as strong. And over the last 3 or 4 years, the evidence is getting stronger and stronger. And so there was an article in the New York Times Science section a few weeks ago about this. So it's getting very interesting. And so either we're going to find a mistake in one of the measurements, or we're going to have to accept there's yet more physics we don't know about. Your other question, now I've forgotten it.
Well,
just remind me, and then I'll...
possibly a silly question, but I'm trying to understand how a single measurement can target a candle
versus expanding at an increasing rate. It can't. And I showed an example of a supernova kind of as a... icon, but it's many, many, many supernova, many, many, many distances that's being measured, and you map out then how the expansion velocity that's measured from each supernova at that distance, how that maps as you go farther and farther out. And if the expansion was steady, hadn't changed, you would just get a straight line. And what they see is it starts to curve over.
So
there's many supernova.
Maybe it will be more clear if it is understood that the distant galaxies are observed at a different time. We are looking at the on the sun 8 minutes ago, and then the galaxy 1,000 years ago, next galaxy 1 billion years ago. So when we are looking at this part, this is also like a time machine. So you are not
aware it's expanding slower.
Yeah.
It was slower in the past. Unless you go really far in the past, in which case it was faster again. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I really don't know what I'm talking about here, but there's an article in last month's Scientific American, and the headline on the front page is, "What's Wrong with Cosmic Inflation?" wonder if you know about this article.
I know about the article, and I know the authors, but I haven't read that article yet. Paul Steinhardt must be one of the authors. Yeah.
I read the article. I can comment. just a sentence from my friend Alan Guth, who is, well, the first author of Inflationary Cosmology. And the reaction was like that. Oh, my God. First it was Trump, and now this.
Fake news.
You're putting me in an awkward spot, you know. I haven't read that article. I know Paul Steinhardt, and some of his arguments are, some are the ones I listed, but some are, you know, it fixes this horizon problem, right? But does it give you even other fine tuning? And there's a debate. Some people say no, it doesn't. Paul thinks it does. Paul argues that can you disprove inflation? Right? So I think Paul would, I don't know anymore, but in the past, Paul said if you see those gravitational waves, you see that signature, that would be, you know, strong evidence for inflation. I don't know if he says that anymore, but if we don't see them, it just means they're weaker than we can detect. It doesn't mean they're not there, right? So I know Paul has had issues with that. Do you want to say any more? You want to? No, he doesn't. I'm an experimentalist, so I can say we just want to go out and measure what's out there.
Is it worth responding to in a letter?
Well, since this question, really, when you open Scientific American, you cannot avoid asking the question. Paul Stanford and his collaborators, they are developing an alternative theory. And that's why there are some emotions involved in how they are doing well or not. And the scientific community mostly does not know how to use the alternative theory, because in order to use it, you need to know how to go through the cosmic singularity, and nobody knows how to do it. Okay? So during the last years, he became very critical to inflationary theory. And his arguments are, they sound interesting, but you must really dig deep into it. Something like he said that inflation is unpredictable, okay? It's just a statement, inflation is unpredictable. And now a Planck satellite, 1,000 people working together, they come with an announcement saying that this prediction of inflation is spectacularly confirmed, okay? Then another prediction of inflation is confirmed. And they, Paul Stanford say, no, it is unpredictable. So how is that? That all predictions by chance made many years ago, they come experimentally checked, verified, and confirmed. And does it mean that inflation, we just dreamed these correct answers? So something like that. Anyway. Yes, please.
Oh.
Did you get any benefit from getting your detectors off planet?
Oh, a huge benefit if you can get your telescope and detectors above the atmosphere. The atmosphere is really a pain in the neck. If you could get them out of the galaxy, it'd be even better, but I think that's tough. The atmosphere, especially when you're doing very large scales, things change in the atmosphere and stuff, so it's tough.
It doesn't seem like that was in your proposal for next step.
The team is not proposing that, but there is, there have been these two satellites, actually three, there's one in between, and they've done great work. What we want to do next, we could do from the ground, and you need high resolution. You need it, which I didn't talk about, for this thing called lensing. So you're going to need something like, 6 meter at least dish, so it gets extremely expensive to do that in space. So we can do it from the ground, and we can do it quicker, and we can do it cheaper. So that's what we're pursuing. But a satellite, there are two proposed to do kind of lower resolution. They'd be complementary, and that'd be great too.
Yes?
So you position in space is expanding itself, is expanding faster than speed of light.
In inflation, yes.
Even now, maybe like in a way, it's expanding. So if a galaxy, two galaxies are very far away, their relative speed is higher, faster than the speed of light.
So there's a horizon that's created from the accelerated universe. So you look far enough away, then things are out of your horizon. Yes, they're moving away from you faster than the speed of light. And if it continues, that horizon will get closer and closer to us.
So what you
but they are not moving.
The space, the that's
the
right.
Space is stretching.
So
it's okay. Einstein is happy with this.
Yeah. Well, one thing I forgot to mention, but you know, I mentioned these shadows we can see of galaxy clusters, right? And when we see those shadows, we measure the spectrum, and we can show that those galaxy clusters, you measure the redshift, they seem to be moving away from us because they're far away, near the speed of light. And our measurements then show, relative to the cosmic microwave background, they're not moving. Or another way, we can show they're not moving relative to space, but that the space between us is expanding. It's hard to get your head around it.
Just to make sure I sort of understand the level of the sort of the magnitude of inflation and how strong it is. So you mentioned that in the early universe, dark matter dominated over dark energy.
Yeah.
Did inflation have to overcome the attraction of the dark matter in the early universe?
For inflation to work, this equivalent to a vacuum energy or a dark energy-like thing had to dominate. But once it dominates, it takes over. Because once it starts driving the expansion faster, everything else is getting diluted. It just takes over until it, for whatever reason, can decay. Every field expected to have a particle.
Every field is expected to have a particle.
In quantized fields, yes, but it's safe to say there's not a complete model of quantized gravity, but the graviton would be the particle of gravity, yes. And if we see these gravitational waves, we would be seeing essentially quantized gravity.
Okay, let it be the last question because the speaker is his second talk today. So please.
Yeah, you mentioned that there'll be a point where if someone was there, they wouldn't be able to see the background radiation. Is that because the horizon has come so close you can't see past that point, or is that because the duration of the event has kind of ended?
What I said is you wouldn't be able to see other galaxies, right? Because the light from them would be pushed out. You would still see radiation, you know, from the Big Bang, but it'd be stretched to such long wavelengths that you might not be able to detect it.
Okay. So the horizon, whatever.
Well, because you're looking back in time to when it emitted, right? Right. I think that should be correct.
So if you allow me, I would conclude it with the following words. I am a theorist. So I'm waking up, and it's California, and a blue sky, and the worst thing that can happen to you is if it's rain. Okay, then these people go to South Pole, it's freezing cold, and they stay there, and they observe at night, that is where they make observations, so it's night all the time, and it's cold all the time, and some of them, instead of that, go to Chile, and sometimes it's the same people, and it's also freezing cold at the height, like 4 kilometers, and now they are dreaming about making a station somewhere in Tibet when the height will be 5 kilometers, where your nose is bleeding, etc. So I want to congratulate all of us with the fact that such people are available, and some of them sometimes come to us.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.